Well, good morning and welcome to New Hope Community Church. It's great to have you with us on Palm Sunday. I don't know what you've been thinking over the last 48 hours, but you have arrived at the beginning of the most incredible week in the history of the world. Amen. The moment of creation. Let me put this on. From the moment of creation through today, the most significant week in the history of the world began with Palm Sunday, and it ended with Easter sunrise. And there are more prophecies fulfilled in this final week that have led more people to put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ than all the others. They've researched the events of this week. Guys like C.S. Lewis and Josh McDowell and my good friend Harris. They have all come to know Christ, and a lot of the things that turned for them from atheism and agnosticism was the fact of the events that happened that were prophesied hundreds and thousands of years before. And just as a reminder, Palm Sunday was a farce. The original Easter week got started on a bad foot, and maybe this is a bad day for you. The good news is it ended on a good note. You see, the problem with that first Palm Sunday is they threw a party for the wrong reason. They threw this big celebration and had a parade for Jesus to enter the streets of Jerusalem. They're up here. Come right on up. We're here to help you. All right. They threw a party for the wrong reason. You see, they celebrated Jesus' arrival in Jerusalem because they thought Jesus was going to come overthrow the Roman government. They were looking for new political clout. They were looking for a person who would make life better for them. Quite frankly, isn't that what most of us do when we go to the polls and vote? We cast a vote for whoever it is we think is going to give us a better life. And that's what the people who lined the streets of Jerusalem that day were doing. They were cheering Jesus on, thought he was coming into town, and he was going to kick out all of the Roman politicians. And in a matter of hours to just days, they discovered Jesus did not come to be a political power. Jesus didn't come to be a ruler of a nation. Jesus came to be the savior of their sins. Jesus came to be the author of their life. Jesus came to do for them what they could never or anybody else could ever do for them. And they got angry at God because he didn't give them what they wanted. He was providing for them what they needed. And so a great question for us to start this week out with is that question. Some of you might be here today and you're a little angry with God. Is it because he's not giving you what you want, though he has provided for all of us everything that we need? And so maybe there needs to be a change of our understanding of what the priorities of life and living are all about. As bad as the way this week got started, it got worse. Before it was all over, the sky turned dark, and God turned his back on his son. But it's in those hours that our debt was paid. It's in those hours that the cost of our sinfulness was wiped out. And then they laid him in a tomb. Friday afternoon, Saturday, bad times. But Easter Sunday morning is what makes this a great week. Have you ever stopped to contemplate that we would not have this thing called spring break? We wouldn't have this thing called Easter week. We would not celebrate Christmas if it wasn't for Easter Sunday morning. Think about that every day this week. And then be in church somewhere Easter Sunday morning. Amen. I'm not telling you got to be here. And if you're a guest today, you're going to say, oh, no, this is another one of those preachers who probably takes role at church. No, that is not the case. You ask anybody who's been here very long, I don't preach on church attendance. I don't think I've ever done it. When you tell me you're going out of town, I usually say, where are you going? And I want to go with you, okay? I tell you to have a great time. We all need to do that. But I got to tell you, there's one Sunday out of the year. If you're not going to be in church, don't tell me. You'll just tick me off. Okay? Because I can't understand how we don't, on this Sunday, of all Sundays, that Easter Sunday morning, how we couldn't be in the place to honor the one who did so much for us. And for me, as Christians, I mean, I can understand when those who don't believe in Christ don't show up. And yet, the interesting thing is that's when the cheesters show up. Okay? You know what cheesters are, right? That's Christmas and Easter. That's the only two Sundays of the year they come. Christmas and Easter. So we kind of blend it, all right? And that's the Sunday they show up. And yet, those who understand what it's all about, oh, yeah, but I got family coming over. I got eggs to hide. Really? Resurrection versus eggs. Yeah. So, I'm not telling you got to be here. You know, if you're traveling, you're going to be with family. Great, great. But Tim, family, bring family with you. Bring them with you. Say, hey guys, this is what I do Easter Sunday morning. We can do everything else after Sunday morning, and we're accommodating because we have an 8 o'clock service in here on Easter Sunday. 9:30, notice the change of time, and 11. Those are the three services next week, all of them in the sanctuary. Slightly different, 8, 9:30, and 11 o'clock. Okay, first sermon's over for the day. Welcome to New Hope Church. If you are a guest today, it is our privilege that you are here. There are some communication cards in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to take one out, fill it out, drop it in the offering bag. Let us know you were here. We promise we will not beat on your door. We will not bother you on the phone, but through the mail, we're going to send you information that tells you about what we believe, who our staff is, the kind of ways that you can get engaged if you would like to, and just hopefully answer a lot of questions you might have about us. So if you just fill that out, drop it in the offering. Thank you so very, very much. Let me highlight a few things because not everything is normal around here this week and lots of special things coming up. So let me hit those and then we'll get engaged in worship. Next week is Easter Sunday. The following week is going to be a special Sunday around New Hope as well. It's going to be Baptism Sunday. We have got almost 20 people to baptize in our two services on that Sunday. So that is an exciting, exciting day for us, from kids, young adults, all the way to more mature seniors. And so we're looking forward to that. Also on that day, during the 10:45 service, there is going to be a deacon and deaconess meeting. It's kind of a big term, all right? If you have interest in serving in the church in some capacity and would like information about that, this would be a great meeting for you to go to. You're not volunteering for anything. It's just an information meeting, but we are kind of reorganizing and revamping how our deacons function here at the church, and they're going to be an umbrella for a lot of our ministries, from parking posse to our ushering to our food that we share with folks who are in need, to a hospital. Hospital visitations when necessary, shut-in visit, a lot of different ways that you can be engaged in service, and this would be a great meeting for you to attend. Please notice that not everything time-wise is normal around here this week. Our high school group, which is not meeting during this service, will be meeting tomorrow night. It'll probably be a very small group. By the way, in case you've forgotten, if you look around and say, oh, I'm not seeing it, we have over 60 people in Mexico this morning. They left out of here at 6:50 a.m. yesterday morning. That's about 42 high schoolers and about 18-plus adults, okay? Ended up in just south of Rosarito, Mexico. The great news is they crossed the border before 4 o'clock. They got to their destination before it was dark and got unpacked and unloaded, and they had homemade tacos waiting for them when they got there, all right? They were all quite excited. Everybody who left arrived, and that was a really good thing. No trouble, no flat tires, all right, no breakdowns of any kind. And you know, they even didn't have any extra bathroom stops. Okay, I sort of gave them a challenge that if they didn't go when they stopped because they said they didn't have to go, that they wouldn't be stopping later when they think they need to go. All right. That getting that many people timely down there is very important. And it worked. They got there. So this is wonderful. We're quite thrilled about that. Let's see here. Women's and Men's Tuesday Night Bible Study will not be meeting this Tuesday. Actually, Now we're not going to show that video of Welcome to Mexico. The lips were out of sync last service, and it was bizarre. There are three things on the sign-up sheet before you pass it on down. The top one is for Friday, April the 21st, if you want to be part of Silent Church. This is a six-hour video Bible study. We've done it the last 3 years here. It's video cast in, and this is an in-depth Bible study, usually relevant to things that are going on in our culture at the time, and it's broadcast from Birmingham, Alabama. Really, really good stuff if you would like to be a part of that, but it is 6 hours, all right, and it's intense. The second thing on here is if you want to be part of the Tuesday Night Women's Bible Study that is starting up the first week of May, they're going to be studying the book of James, and the last one is if you want to go on a motorcycle ride the last Saturday of April, all right, and they're heading over to the coast for that. So there will not be Tuesday evening men and women's Bible study. There will not be Wednesday night or Wednesday morning women's Bible study. There will not be Wednesday night junior high or fifth and sixth grade activities. The only spiritual ones in the church family are the Thursday morning men's Bible study at 6 a.m. They will be meeting for Bible study. Just kidding. They actually voted to meet, okay? So I guess I have to show up now. All right, I think I've covered everything else that I need to highlight, so let's talk about a couple of prayer requests. Jordan's mother's here, and Jordan is home recovering from her surgery she had in Stanford last Monday. We couldn't have asked for things to have gone better with the surgery. Everything the doctor said would happen happened, and the outcomes were everything that he wanted. She gave up a rib. She gave back to Adam, all right? So they removed the rib that was diseased and think that will take care of the issue. She had a few complications with an allergic reaction, probably to the latex or the Band-Aid. But apart from that, she is home recuperating, doing well, and we like those results. Heidi Stoll from our church had surgery at Kaiser this week. She is still recuperating there at the hospital. If you would please remember a couple of families, Dean Leonard and Keith Drawn, two services that we had here at the church this week. Pray for God's care and comfort in their lives, if you would please. Dean gave us kind of an interesting story. Her name was Emma Dean. Okay, and so she obviously shortened it to Dean. Delightful lady. She was her father was born in Oklahoma. He was a country western recording artist in the mid-1940s. His name was Oklahoma Ed Moody. Okay, actually a few people in the earlier services they had heard of him. And I Googled him, found out, man, he recorded 20 songs in the middle of the 40s, had that sound that you would expect at that period of time, and was quite fascinating. He was born in Cement, Oklahoma. Yeah, it's a really hard place to live. I used that one yesterday. It turned out pretty good. When you have to explain the jokes, it's bad, but I'm glad y'all got it. Yeah. My dad was born about 45 miles north, directly north from Cement, Oklahoma. It wasn't quite as hard to live there. It was called Dibble, all right? So a little easier living. 501 people live in Cement, okay? So, yeah, it's a drag. But you can understand why they wouldn't live there, all right? But anyway, be praying for both of those families. They were wonderful families, and we want God's comfort and best in their lives. Well, those are the updates that we wanted to bring to you today. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward, wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. We also have a group of our folks who are in prison today, all right, engaged in some ministries there again this weekend. Please be praying for some of us. We'll be at Folsom Prison on Friday, sharing in a Good Friday service. I get to share in that service with Francis Chan. So some of you are familiar with Francis. We've done a Bible study of his around here. Terrific pastor in the Bay Area. And so we'll be sharing together at Folsom Prison. Join with me as we pray. Father, we love you. We thank you for your incredible, unbelievable love for us. You saw our deepest needs and you did whatever was necessary to meet them. And we say thanks for that today. We say thank you that whatever catches us by surprise never catches you unaware. Things which happen in our life that sometimes confuse us and trouble us, catch us off guard, you are prepared for. And God, you tell us that the surprises of our life do not have to catch us unprepared. That's what a healthy relationship with you is all about, is knowing that we can trust you with the good and the bad and the ugly of life, and that you are sufficient for us during those times. Father, there are a variety of people who have needs here today, some that are related to surgeries that they've just had. Some are in the midst of recovery, and others, Father, are waiting for test results. Some are waiting for dates and times to schedule tests. Wherever we are in those arenas of physical need, Father, I'm so grateful that we can trust you in the waiting rooms of life and in the recovery seasons of life. Dear Father, for those who are experiencing difficulties because of job or lack of employment, I've heard of two today who came to me and said, Pastor, thanks for praying, but we got jobs this week. So we're grateful for that. Father, for those who may have shown up here with really some uncertainty, they just knew that they needed to be in church somewhere today. They needed to hear your voice speak to them. That I pray through the music and the message today that they will hear your voice. They'll hear your truth. Not a man-made version of truth, but Father, your truth. So give us clarity of thought as we speak it today. For the privilege of giving and sharing, we say thanks. The opportunity to express our gratitude for how you have met our needs. For our kids and the staff that's with them and the adults who are helping them in Mexico, thank you for the transformation that will take place and lives who are going to hear the gospel, some for the very first time. For our own kids, Father, some of them are there thinking that they're going to be giving out to somebody else and they're going to discover some things about themselves that will be life-changing. Thank you for what you do in and through them. We commit all this to you and so much more. In the name of your Son, the Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen. It's terrific. All right, guys, let's take a couple of minutes to review, get caught up, and then jump into things for today. We're in the midst of a series called Enemies of the Heart. Just as there are enemies of this physical heart that pumps blood and keeps blood circulating through our system, things like high cholesterol and high blood pressure and heart disease. Just heard between services of a gentleman in our heart who had a heart attack last year and he's had some other difficulties. They finally diagnosed at UC Davis what the problem was. And it's a long term that I've never heard before, and it boils down to it's an autoimmune disease that attacks the heart. And we have these enemies of our physical heart that do their best to destroy it. And just as we have enemies of this physical heart, the Bible tells us that there's an invisible part of our life that's also called the heart. Jeremiah 17:9 describes it this way. The heart is deceitful above all things. It is desperately wicked or beyond cure. Who can understand it? And that's that part of us that that causes my heart to skip a beat when Shelley walks into a room. That's not my physical heart that does that. That's the invisible heart. It's my invisible heart that when I'm reminded of a betrayal in my life that makes me angry and brings bitterness up like bile in a throat. It is that invisible heart that causes me to dream and hope and have expectations. It's not this physical heart. And so, just as there are enemies of the physical heart, we can discover out of Scripture that there are also enemies to this invisible heart of ours. And we spent about 4 or 5 weeks looking at who some of the key enemies of this invisible heart are. Do you remember what those 4 enemies, not necessarily in order of priority, but in the order in which we shared them with you? Do you remember what those 4 enemies were? The first one was guilt, all right? And guilt, with each one of these enemies, we kind of gave a 3-word sentence that describes how that reflects itself in our life. Do you remember what the 3-word sentence was for guilt? I owe you. Guilt means I've done something to you, against you, and I owe you a debt. It may not always be a monetary debt, but it's a debt of some kind. What was the 2nd enemy of the heart? The first one was guilt, I owe you. The 2nd one is anger. Anger clogs the arteries of our invisible heart, and anger says what? You owe me. You have offended and hurt me. And you owe me. The 3rd enemy of the heart that we looked at is greed. Good. You all are better than the other 2 services. I had to pull greed out of them, all right? Which is probably what God has to do with most of us on that subject, all right? So greed, when we don't, and what's the 3-word sentence to greed? I owe me. I deserve. And so we go out of the way to get what we think we owe ourselves. And then the last enemy of the heart is jealousy. And jealousy says what? God owes me. It's not that I want to take from my neighbor what my neighbor has, but it's the fact, God, if you let him have that, how come I don't have one? God, I think you owe me. And so we identified the enemies. And then last week we began to look at what's the cure for this invisible heart disease. Just as there are bad habits that we get into that create high cholesterol, high blood pressure, and some of these other diseases of the heart, they often are there because of bad habits. We can sometimes reverse the impact of that by creating new habits. And what is true with the physical heart is also true with this invisible heart. And so last week we began to take the first step in looking at how we confront guilt with a new habit. Do you recall what we started with last week? Confession. My dad used to quote somebody, and he didn't know who it was, and quite frankly, I've Googled this quote, and it's attributed to no one. Confession is good for the soul, but it's lousy for the reputation. And so often we don't like to engage in it, all right, because our reputations tend to be very, very important to us. And yet, confession is the good habit that we need to cultivate in our heart if we're going to deal with the disease or the problem of guilt. I started that, initiated it last week, and we're going to try to wrap up this habit of confession in our life. I have to be honest, I have struggled in the last two services with this sermon. This is one that I really do not want to be misunderstood on, and I do not want to convey that there is any kind of work orientation to our redemptive relationship with Jesus Christ. That this is an act of God's grace. It is a free gift that we generously receive. But I believe we shortchange that gift that God has given to us if we don't recognize what true confession also involves. And so we're going to talk about the second part of that today. And I hope to make it clear between those two distinctives. As I shared last week, I grew up in a culture that took this pendulum of confession to one extreme. And what often happens with us is when we want to resist the extreme, we often swing the pendulum to the other extreme. And probably God's best is somewhere in the middle. God chooses to bring balance to our lives. And so I've had to confess last week, and I'm doing it again today, that I have probably erred a bit in the ministry as a pastor in the way in which I invite and draw people to enter into a relationship with Jesus Christ. And some of you are looking at me with eyes of, what in the heck are you talking about? Is this ringing out there to you guys? Okay, good. It's just in my head. Not the first time I've heard that. But here's the culture I grew up in. I make no apologies for being raised a Baptist, all right? No apologies to that. I have so much to appreciate my heritage for. I was very blessed in a lot of ways. But I grew up in a culture, as most Baptists were, whether you were Southern Baptist, First Baptist, Northern Baptist, Free Will Baptist, Hard Shell Baptist, Missionary Baptist. And the reason there's so many Baptists is they simply couldn't all get along in one place. And so they just sort of did this thing. Whether you grew up in an Assembly of God culture, many Mennonite cultures, you could pick just about almost any denomination of the evangelical persuasion. And in the 50s and the 60s and 70s, this would have been the case. And here's what I'm talking about. Every service we went to, they gave an altar call. We had altars in the front of the church. And by the way, probably when we finish our remodel, I'm going to put some altars back in this church. Again, I think I swung too far. I used to often say altars always look to me like a barrier. I'm thinking maybe they're more of a bridge than a barrier. And I think there's a need for us to recognize that sometimes there is a need to lay our all on the altar. And there's something about seeing that that may be very, very helpful for us. So hopefully I'm going to swing back to the middle here and not to the extreme. But I grew up in a culture, every service, Sunday night, Sunday morning, Wednesday nights, altar calls were given. And I understand part of the reason is because pastors in those days felt like job security was based upon people coming to the altar at the end of the service. Some of you who grew up, would you say that probably is a little bit of it? I mean, a preacher's effectiveness was, can he get people in the altar? And so that's why you would sing 24 verses of Just As I Am at the end of a service, is to wear people down, to get the comfort. And the pastor would say, all right, maybe we don't have anybody who need to come and become a Christian, but maybe there are some of you Christians, you've been backsliding. My grandfather used to say, we preach about backsliding so often, the people think they need to practice it. And so, then finally you begin to think, okay, maybe if I go forward, he'll end this thing and we could go have lunch. And so you come forward. And so we had this extremism. And the worst I ever heard, and this is a true story because the brother-in-law told it to me. This was a church in Kerman. This is several years ago. But there were four people in service that night. The preacher, his wife, his mother-in-law, and his brother-in-law. He preached a full sermon, and then he gave an invitation at the end of the sermon. I'm not sure who he was pointed at, whether it was his wife, his mother-in-law, his brother-in-law, but one of them needed Jesus, all right? And he gave an altar call. And so that's the pendulum that went this way. And so where I've ended up is, over the last couple of decades, is that there's no reason to come forward. You can invite Jesus Christ in your heart right there in your pew, in the quietness of this moment, and you can. Nothing about that really has to change. But sometimes we've made it so easy and we've made it so private that nobody would even know that you've made a decision. And maybe you didn't. What really got to me was 2 weeks ago, 2.5 weeks ago, when I went into prison. And Dean Johnson, the strong man, we're going to have him here sometime this summer. Ladies, you're going to love this guy. I'm going to have to preach on lust before I invite him, but you're going to love this guy, man. He's 6'2", and he's chiseled rock shoulders and trim in the waist, and yeah, he's a hunk. And this guy, you know, he squeezes Coke cans till they burst open, and he tears a phone book right across the middle, and he takes a rebar, puts it in his mouth, and he bends it. It's impressive. And he's got quite a story and quite a message. And I remember him in the yard, and you got to remember in prison, these guys, many of them been members of gangs. They identify with color, they identify with tattoos. They stand even in these services, kind of in their clusters of gang activity. And the strong man, after he had demonstrated his physical strength, he then revealed his spiritual strength. And he shared his story of how he came to know Christ. And then he extended an invitation to these men in a prison yard. He said, I want you to raise your heads and I want you to make sure your eyes are open. And he said, if you've heard something today that has prompted you to say, I need Jesus Christ and I need to confess my sin, that I may end my life in a prison cell, but I can spend eternity in God's home. You may spend the rest of your life on a prison yard, but you will not walk around here condemned any longer because you've been set free by the grace of God. If you want that in your life, he said, I want you to step forward with your head up and your eyes open, and I want you to come stand on this line right here. And he stood and watched. And it got quiet. And all of a sudden, one man moved. And then another one. And then another one. And before it was over, 30 men stood here. No longer a member of a gang, but now a member of God's family. And what was so powerful to me about that was, you want to talk about the hardest place in the world to do, take a public stand for Jesus Christ, is to say, I'm leaving the gang and I'm stepping into God's family. eyes open, head up. You see, there is something, and I'm not sure how to take this to extremes, but there is the passage which says, if you are ashamed of me in this life, I'll be ashamed of you before my Father. So this whole idea of private confession does have some boundaries to it. I'm not sure all that is there, but I know we got to deal with some of it. Mark Downs, where are you, Mark? Come on up, buddy. I volunteered him in the 8 o'clock service. I was actually going to volunteer others in each service, and Mark said, I'll stay for all three. So Mark has endured this twice already, all right? And if you'll recall, we ended last Sunday's sermon with taking you through some of the 12 steps that they go through and celebrate recovery. And I thought they were very eye-opening about this whole subject of confession, that I think there's some great value to what they do in CR that we need to incorporate into our daily life. And remember, Celebrate Recovery is not just for drug addicts and drunks. It is for anybody who has habits, hang-ups, and hurts in their life. And so there's some great value to this. And so what we're going to do today at the outset of this is we're going to do exactly what they do in Celebrate Recovery. They do this every single week in Celebrate Recovery. At some point before they close down their study together, two people are called up, and one of them will read, or they will recite what the 12 steps are. And after each step, somebody will quote the scriptural foundation for that step. And so Mark and I are going to do that like they would in a CR. Now, Mark, what would you do in a CR when I called you up from the audience? What would you do?
Good morning to my forever family. I struggled with addiction, and I love Jesus, and my name is Mark.
Ah, some of you been. All right, that's good. That's good. That's exactly what they do. So do you see something that's taking place there? One, he's admitting what his problem was, the thing that he dealt with that was the most difficult and challenging thing in his life. He's not still an addict, but that was what his struggle was with. And he confessed it, and he identified himself. I find value in that. Now, let's do the 12 steps. So, if you'd like to read step one.
Step one says, we admitted that we are powerless over our addiction and compulsive behaviors that our lives have become unmanageable.
Obviously, he's done this often enough, he doesn't need to read them here, all right? He has them memorized. The scriptural support for that passage is Romans 7:18, for I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out.
Step two, we came to believe that a power greater than ourselves can restore us to sanity.
Philippians 2:1, for it is God who works in you the will and to act according to his good pleasure.
Step three, we made a decision to turn our will and our life over to God.
Romans 12:1. Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, that we present our bodies as living sacrifices, wholly acceptable unto him, which is our spiritual worship.
Apparently he knows them too.
Some of the verses, yeah.
Step four, we made a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves.
Okay. Read that one again. Say it again.
Step four, we made a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves.
You know, if it just said we made a searching moral inventory, it wouldn't have as much punch. But then it says fearless. That means I'm going to look at every single corner of my life. I want to know me for what I really am. Lamentations 3:4 says, let us examine our ways and test them, and let us return to God. We'll find out we've probably wandered away, so let us return.
Step five, we admitted to God, to ourselves, and to another human being that's exactly what you want.
Okay, say that one again.
Step five, we admitted to God.
Okay, we don't have a problem with that one.
We admitted to ourselves.
Okay, we don't struggle with that one too much.
Number five, we admitted to God, to ourselves, and to another human being that's exactly what you want.
Wow, there's where the accountability comes in. All right, James 5:16 says, therefore confess your sins to each other and pray, and you will be healed. Remember, Jeremiah 17:9 says that our heart is sick. James says, pray, confess, pray, find healing.
Number six, we are entirely ready to have God remove all these defects of dirt.
James 4:10 says, humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up.
Number 7, how do we ask him to remove our shortcomings?
Humbly. There is a process of humility in confession. And 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Important thing to understand here. 1 John 1:9 was written by the disciple John, and he wrote it to a church. He was not writing this to a group of unchurched and still yet unsaved people. 1 John 1:9 is written to believers in a church that we still have a process of confession, not for our sin nature, but for our sins. Okay? This is what Jesus meant when he told Peter, hey, I want to wash your feet. And Peter said, no. Jesus said, hey, if I don't wash your feet, you have no part with me. And Peter said, well, then give me a shower. And Jesus said, no, it's not your whole body that's dirty. It's your feet. And the illustration in this involvement was, hey, through life, we collect a little dirt in our lives. Let's keep short accounts. And that's what John is telling us here. Confess within the context of our relationship with God. Number 8.
Number 8, we made a list of all persons that we have harmed and became willing to make amends to them all.
Wow. Have you ever done that? Made a list to all you've harmed. Luke 6:31, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Number 9.
Number 9, we made a list of all persons that we have harmed and became willing to make amends to them all, except when you do so that would enter them with others.
So, in this whole thing of confession in our human relationships, we need to be a bit cautious. Make sure we're not going to bring harm to somebody else as we go through this process. This is not just to relieve our guilt, all right? This is about a change of life for us and for them. Matthew 5:23, if you're offering a gift at the altar, and remember that your brother has something against you, then leave your gift in front of the altar. Go and be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift.
Step 10, we continue to take personal inventory, and when we were wrong, we promptly amended it.
We continue. It's not once and done. 1 Corinthians 10:12. So if you think you are standing firm, be careful lest you fall.
Step 11.
We sought
through prayer and meditation.
First time we can do that.
Praying only for the knowledge of his will and the power to carry that out. He knows.
Colossians 3:16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Don't be poor with God's word. Let it dwell in you richly. Step 12,
having had a spiritual experience as a result of these steps, we try to carry this message to others and practice these principles in all our affairs.
Galatians 6:1, Paul said, brothers, if someone is caught in a sin, you who are spiritual, restore them gently, but watch yourself that you may not also be tempted. Mark, thank you very much. You may go home now if you'd like. Can't hand this to them in the back. So let's look at this second part of confession, all right? And this really has more to do with after our moment of repentance. Confession is a habit that we need to cultivate in our Christian life. You see, if we look into the New Testament, at Luke chapter 19, this is just the chapter before the story of the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. We have the story of a short little tax collector. Many of us learned a song when we were kids going to vacation Bible school or church camp or Sunday school. Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and a wee little man was he. All right, you remember that one? Yeah. Well, this is the story. This is the biblical truth. All right? Chapter 19 of Luke's gospel. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. Didn't plan on hanging out there long. He had to get to a parade. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector, and he was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but being a short man, he could not because of the crowd. So he ran ahead and he climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and he said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. So he came down at once and he welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter. Are you a mutterer? It's not healthy for you, all right? All the people saw this and they began to mutter, "He's gone to be the guest of a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor, and if I've cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount." See, he wasn't a good Jew, but he knew the principles of Judaism. And he was willing to go further than what the principles were. Why? Because his life had been changed. Jesus said, "Today, salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. He's a son of faith, for the Son of Man have come to seek and to save those who are lost." Wow. Zacchaeus wasn't that cute little man depicted in our childhood songs and Sunday school classes. Zacchaeus was a wicked man, considered a traitor to his nation. He had wronged many of his fellow Jews, leaving a trail of relational wreckage in his wake. But when Jesus invited himself over to Zacchaeus' house that day, that little tax collector was changed. He found in Jesus the hope and the forgiveness that he had long since given up on. But Zacchaeus knew exactly that it wasn't enough to just confess his sins to Jesus. That was a first step, but it wasn't the only step. "Look, Lord," he said, "here and now I give half my possessions to the poor, and if I have cheated anybody, I will pay back four times the amount." What did Jesus say to this? Did he say, "Oh, no, Zacchaeus, you don't have to do that. You're forgiven. That's part of your past. You don't have to make a restitution. There's no need for a public spectacle." No, Jesus said, "In effect, now I know for sure that salvation has come to your house. You are a changed heart." Zacchaeus didn't just admit the sins of his past. He took public responsibility for them. He confessed them in the truest of senses. Over and over, the Bible speaks of confession not in terms of conscience relief, but of a life changed. Are you with me on this? We don't do this just so we can feel better about ourselves. We do this because I want a change in the direction of my life. And sometimes there are costs that come with that change. No doubt, this is what Jesus had in mind when he shocked his listeners with a bit of instruction that we've already quoted with the 12 steps. Matthew 5:23, "Therefore, if you're offering your gift at the altar and you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift at the altar. Go and be reconciled to them, then come and offer your gift." This is about relational forgiveness. Forgiveness that we receive from Christ, if we've had a changed life, will reflect itself in relational forgiveness with each other. Can you imagine what the Jews must have thought when they heard Jesus say this? Because it was different in those days than it is now. I mean, a good Jew, when he went to church to get things right, he brought his little lamb. And they were prepared to offer it as a sacrifice so that the relationship between them and God would be right for a year. And Jesus is now telling them, "Hey, hold up with that lamb. Why don't you tie it to a peg? Go to the person that you have wronged. Find forgiveness with them. Then come back to your lamb. And then bring it to God." They'd never heard anything like that before. And Jesus was telling them, "Hey, guilt loses the foothold in your heart, and the power of sin is broken in your life when you deal with the fractured relationships that I bring to your attention. If you deal with those, guilt is gone." Open confession has the power to break the cycle of sin. Actually, I think that's part of the purpose of public confession. Just like most medicinal remedies, it works when properly applied. You see, if you start confessing your sins to the people you've sinned against, odds are you're going to stop sinning against them. If you go to your boss and say, "Hey, boss, I've been cheating on my quarterly statistics so that I look like I'm doing better than what I'm doing. Do you think you'll cheat the next quarter?" Probably not, because your boss is going to look for it next quarter, all right? You've set a standard that says, "Hey, I was wrong. I shouldn't have done that." If you muster the courage to confess to a friend, that you reveal to somebody something that they told you in confidence. If you tell your friend, "I'm sorry, I gossiped," you probably won't be as likely to gossip the next time. And your friend might not be as likely to tell you next time. They will do so very cautiously. Guilty people are usually repeat offenders. And as long as you're carrying a secret, as long as you're trying to ease your conscience by telling God how sorry you are, you're setting yourself up to repeat the past. However, confession, the way God designed confession to be applied, breaks the cycle of this sin and guilt. And that's just the beginning. And by the way, do you know who's doing a better job of this kind of confession than the church? Weight Watchers. You know what I'm talking about? I've never been to Weight Watchers, but my mother went off and on for years. She'd tell me what it was like when you go. What do you have to do at Weight Watchers? You've got to, is that in a little private cubicle in the back? It's right up front when you walk in. And when it's a good report, they cheer. If you stand on the scales and nobody's cheering, guess what? You got caught. See, it's public. That's accountability that comes in that process. I don't know that we as a church have done very good at that. Andy Stanley tells a story in his book about when this really came home true to him. It came home to roost. He was preaching for his dad one Sunday morning. And he was preaching about how if we are living in integrity as Christians, that the President of the United States could appoint us as Attorney General and we wouldn't have anything to be afraid about. And he said, as soon as that came out of my mouth, God put a memory in my mind of something that I had done against somebody else, and I've never dealt with it. It's 20 years later. He said, after that sermon was over, man, it was nagging at me, and I thought, okay, God, I've already confessed this to you. I've dealt with it. It's 20 years old. I've been forgiven. I'm moving on. And he writes in there, he said, I woke up the next morning and the next morning, and this was on my mind from the time I woke up till I went to bed. Finally, in the middle of the afternoon, in the middle of the week, I jumped in my car and I ran over to this man's house. Now, the reason this incident had occurred is because this man had been in his dad's church and he was causing lots of problems and saying ugly things about his dad. And he was only about 13 or 14 at the time, but he was going to get him. I don't know what it was. Andy didn't tell me. Maybe he was afraid that, you know, some of the rest of us would try the same thing. So he just simply said, what I did was illegal, and it wasn't nice. And he said, I knocked on that man's door. He said he had left my dad's church a decade before. I hadn't seen him in a decade. But God kept working in my heart on this. I went and I knocked on his door, and the man opened the door and looked at me and said, Andy, come in, let's have a cup of coffee. And he said, we sat down at his kitchen table. And I confessed to him what I'd done. He said, Andy, I haven't thought about that in 20 years. And I will admit to you, when that thing first happened, I wondered for a brief second, I wonder if Andy Stanley did that. And he said, then I put it out of my mind as an impossible possibility. And he said, then that man got up and came over and he hugged me and he said, Andy, thank you. Not that this has been a problem for me, but thank you that you've given me an example of what I need to do with somebody else. And Andy said, when I walked out of that man's house that day, I didn't know I'd been living under a burden until I found out what it was like to walk out without a burden. And it was so rewarding. I got to tell you, the closest thing I've known personally of something like that happening, he won't mind me telling it today. He's not here today. And he's short also, kind of like Zacchaeus. It's Joe Avila. Okay. Joe's told his story here multiple times. For those of you who don't know, Joe is the head of prison fellowship in the Western region. Well, actually, I understand that's all changed now. Yeah, we'll talk about that later. No, he's still with him, just a different capacity. I could say that now because I know his staff knows. You do know, right? Yes. Oh. I kept looking over out there for some nodding of your head, and I wasn't getting much of it. Yeah. But so you don't know Joe's story. Joseph was a salesman. He was a good husband and a fine dad, and lived in a very nice middle class neighborhood. Joe did what he did every week. He worked hard and took care of his family. And on Fridays he would stop off at the local watering hole with a few buddies and drop back a few and relax heading into the weekend. And on one of those Fridays, he got in his car, and a young high school student, a girl, stepped off the curb out in front of him, and he hit and killed her. He was arrested and arraigned. At his arraignment, he pled not guilty under the direction of his attorney. And after his arraignment and he was out on bond, Joe realized he needed help. And so Joe looked around for programs and found Salvation Army. And at Salvation Army, Joe found salvation. Joe found Jesus Christ. And when it was time for Joe to show up at his court date, he did what his attorney had advised him not to do. Joe changed his plea. The attorney said, "If you plead not guilty and we take this to trial, we can get you a reduced sentence." And Joe said, "I am now a Christian. I cannot lie." And he changed his plea to guilty. And he got the maximum at that time, and it wasn't good. And Joe served 4/5 of his sentence. That's how we eventually got acquainted, okay? I did not know Joe before prison. I knew Joe after prison. We met his wife and daughters through a support group, and they became part of our church family and part of our own family. We spent a lot of holidays together while Joe was incarcerated. But you see, when we make a confession to Christ and our sins are forgiven, that secures the payment price for the penalty of our sins. But that does not necessarily deliver us from all the consequences in our human relationships because of our sin. As Joe had to make a change in his plea, sometimes we have to make a change with others. Now, wait a minute, some of you are saying, what about forgiveness? If God has forgiven me of all of my sin, why do I need to dredge up a bunch of stuff from my past when it's all been paid for at the cross? Besides, I wasn't even a Christian when I did some of those things. When I hear people make these kind of arguments, I have to smile a bit because I've used them myself. When all the theological gymnastics, though, are finished, our guilt still remains. Why? Because God is not always the only offended party in our life. Besides, the same Bible that assures us of God's forgiveness also teaches us the principle of restitution. Forgiveness doesn't erase our need to take responsibility for what we've done. In fact, forgiveness should drive our confession. When we become a Christian, we come face to face with the unconditional, undeserved grace of God. And when God has been so generous to do for us what we could not do for ourselves, how can then we not then offer the same grace to others who we have offended? If God is giving to us who have offended Him deeply, it's us who put Him on a cross. It is us who put nails in His hands. It is us who thrust a spear in His side. It is us who put a crown of thorns on His head. If He did all of that for us, then how can we not offer some of that to others around us? And just maybe, as they see us offer to them His grace through us, they may be drawn to His grace at the cross for themselves. You see, that very grace compels us to make restitution to those that we have wronged. The penalty of our sin, insofar as heaven and hell are concerned, has been dealt with once and for all. The consequences of our sin are a different matter, sometimes altogether. If you really want to understand the power of confession, turn this around just a little bit. Put yourself on the receiving end of someone's confession. Think for a moment. Whose apology do you most desire and least expect. Who in your life has potentially hurt you the deepest, harmed you the most, and you do not expect ever to hear from them? Who is it that seems to be completely insensitive and probably unaware of the trouble or hurt they've caused? Imagine how you would feel if they pulled an Andy Stanley on you and you got a surprise visit from them. How would you feel if they walked in, sat down, and took full responsibility for what they had done? My guess is we would never be the same again. It would be impossible for us to resist the changes that would begin to take place in our heart. That, I believe, is the power of confession. God's forgiveness doesn't exempt us from the responsibility of confession and restitution. On the contrary, His forgiveness is the very reason that should lead us to those decisions. At some point in our journey, God is going to call on us to turn and take responsibility for our past. It never fails. Unresolved relationships, debts that have been neglected, apologies never made, these are things God will eventually lead us to own and resolve. I know it's painful. There is no question it is inconvenient. Embarrassing. Downright humiliating at times. But our Savior suffered a very painful, inconvenient, and terribly humiliating death on a Roman cross for the sake of our past, present, and future sins. They were not even His own sins. He took responsibility for all of ours. And He did that so that you and I could be reconciled to His Father. Let's just face up to it today. In the shadow of the cross, all of our excuses, all of our griping, all of our rationalization really amount to nothing. We have no excuse. His death was for our good, and His commands regarding confession and reconciliation are for our good as well. He wants us to be completely free from the enslavement of all of our sins. Confession enables us to come out from the shadows of the sin into the light where all things are made new. So the habit of confession. This is not a singular event once we become a Christian. This becomes a habit of our lives. It wasn't too many weeks ago. I may have to confess over what I'm about to say. It hasn't been too many months ago that after a sermon, when Shelley and I got home, she asked my forgiveness. I got to tell you, I don't even remember now what she was asking my forgiveness over. God, I think, does a great job at giving us good forgetters when we deal with confession and sin the right way, because that's what He does with our sin. He puts them behind His back and He buries them in the deepest, darkest sea that He can find. And He says, I'll never remember them again, and I will not go dig them up. They are not hidden treasures. And I thought, wow, how humbling it was for me to have her confess to me. It was a great day. I didn't even really realize there was an issue. But confession requires humility and offering forgiveness, which is where we're going to head in a week. So confession needs to be a habit. So if it is, we need to keep short accounts with each other. We need to do that in husband-wife relationships. We need to do that in parent-child relationships. We need to do that in our sibling relationships. We need to do that in our church family. Remember, the purpose of confession is not to relieve our conscience. It's to effect change and reconciliation. Leverage this powerful tool in the way that it was intended. Sometimes that means go public with your sin. Purge your heart of the guilt that's eroding your confidence in your faith. I always have to be careful here. I don't want you to air dirty laundry that's 50 years old. This is talking about The things between us are the things that destroy our lives. It's what's so good about Celebrate Recovery. It creates this habit. The consequences of confession are far less severe than the consequences of concealment. Secrets are buried splinters. What's the best thing to do with a splinter? Dig it out first. What happens if you don't? It festers. Can I use a word my dad used to use when I was a kid and I let a splinter fester? Yeah, somebody whispered it out there. He would say, if I'd have done that sooner, you wouldn't have all this pus. Isn't that an ugly word? That's why it's a perfect word for this. Because this is what happens to our relationships when we don't deal with them the way we should. And let me tell you what's sad. It's when you are with a family and there is a casket right here. And you watch a son or a daughter sit right here and say, I wished I had one more day to apologize. I should have said I was sorry. I need just one more day. That's when you see the pus, and it's ugly, and it's horrible, and God gives us a way to deal with the splinters. So let me wrap this up. You got any secrets? Have you been playing the confession game like so many of the rest of us? Are you relieving your conscience but not desiring real change? Are you ready to break that cycle? Then the good habit that deals with guilt is confession. That's a habit that can change everything. We dealt with this subject just a few months ago on our Thursday morning men's Bible study. I remember the following week we had two, if not three, men come back and say, we went to people that we needed to apologize to. Our own associate pastor, Mark Addis, talked about going to a business associate who had stabbed him in the back, who had betrayed him. And he didn't go to that person asking him to apologize to him. He went and apologized for the bitterness he had in his heart. You saw the mood in that men's Bible study just change. And whoa. Some of us realize we need the courage to do the same thing. So here's the question for you. I told you last week, I'm actually surprised so many of you are here today, because I told you I was going to give an altar call last Sunday. Here's what I'm going to ask today. I'm going to take 30 seconds, and I'm going to ask you to pray. And I'm going to ask you, here's what I know. You're saying, 30 seconds? Is that all you're giving me? Here's what I'm pretty confident of. If there is something in your heart that you need to deal with, God has probably already told you during the sermon what it is. I suspect there is a name or a circumstance or a situation. It's already hurting, sensitive. And you know you need to deal with that next week or the next opportunity that God provides. I'm going to give you 30 seconds for those who maybe haven't quite gotten that frame of mind yet. And see if God brings to your attention something that this is a matter I need to deal with. Would you bow your heads? Take 30 seconds. Okay, so here's the open confession for this service. If there is something that you know you need to deal with, God has brought conviction, and you know this is something that you need to deal with. You've identified it, and you have a willingness to deal with it. That's where you are right now. You know, and you have a willingness to deal with it. Would you raise your hand? Okay? Perfect. All right? I know there's something I need to deal with, and I'm willing to deal with it. Perfect. Good. In a couple of weeks, I'm going to ask you for a show of hands again if you dealt with it. Now, don't rush. Remember some of the principles we read to you. Don't do harm to others. Make sure this is God's working in your heart, and this is about you and your attitude, not them. Now, for the rest of you who didn't raise your hand, let me ask you, you're not out of the woods yet. Are you willing to remain open for God's leadership to reveal to you if there are some things that you need to do, 1 John 1:9? You have an open heart towards doing that as God provides opportunity and direction. If you have that kind of heart today, would you raise your hand and hold it up? Wonderful. God bless you. Go have a great afternoon. Where am I going to see you next Sunday? Well, if not here, in church somewhere. Okay? Easter Sunday. God bless you.